This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so welcome all to the class. So this is like a most requested topic. People send me messages. So this is BIVA guideline for the management of HIV in pregnancy and postpartum. Though the new guideline has come in 2018, but they keep on updating it. Some updates are also there in 2020. Okay, so I have included everything. So hope that things will go better for you. I try to make simplified it. So whenever I'm not clear, you people can ask me question, okay? Okay, so to start with, though a few things are important here. How HIV transmits, we already know. What are the modes of transmission? It's sexual, it is an STD. So sexual intercourse, IV drug abusers, transfusion of blood and blood products, so and also vertical transmissions. So as we are doing this guideline that is about HIV in pregnancy, so we are more worried about vertical transmission. And whatever the measures we take in pregnancy, if the woman has come HIV positive, that we have got only one aim, that vertical transmission or mother to be, child transmission should be reduced. So what could be the risk of vertical transmission? It could be from 25% to 40% in breastfeeding populations. Okay, in UK previously we used to give heart, that was high active entry retroviral therapy, and they used to avoid breastfeeding. So with heart and avoidance of breastfeeding, it is 1% vertical transmission. But now they have changed it to CART. CART is a combined antiretroviral therapy. So transmission rate, if the woman is on CART and undetectable viral load, that means undetectable viral load is a term used when the viral load is less than 50. So if the woman is on CART and undetectable viral load is there, then, and she is not breastfeeding, then in that particular situation, transmission rate is 0.57% or less than 1%. So from where I'm speaking about these numbers, this is from Strategy. So please don't get confused about the number of transmission, because previously for the exam we used to do at number, remember this numbers from TOG 2012, but that was old TOG. So now, because as the guideline has been updated, and also it would be better to remember new numbers, and these are the strategy numbers. So for you people, you have to remember only two number. So if the woman is on heart and avoiding breastfeeding, risk of vertical transmission is 1%. That is a number to be remembered. And if the woman is on heart and undetectable viral load, so these two, just remember, if the questions come, woman on heart and undetectable viral load, what will be the risk of transmission? It is 0.57%. Usually they will ask you less than 1%. So that will be your question, and the source is Strategy. Now, a few things. So 95% of the women in UK are screened for HIV. So when you already know from your antenatal guideline, NICE guideline. So it is in UK, there is universal screening for HIV. Okay. So so it is universal. So if the woman comes positive, accordingly the treatment can be done. And we have got only one aim, that to avoid vertical transmission. So how the tests are done? So there are two types of tests are done. In basic knowledge, it is important. There is a test for antigen, and also there is a test for antibody. Test for P24 antigen, and it will be detectable within 1 month of infection. Maybe you get question from this line, or if the antibody testing is done. So antibody testing may take up to 3 months. Therefore, that window period is there that we already know. And once a test has come positive for anyone, it is a STD that carries stigma and so many psychological issues are there. So when the one test comes positive, then always second test, confirmatory test is also done before the news has been broken to patient. Okay. So sometimes you will find a question, both part two and part three people. So if they have done an antenatal booking test, but all of a sudden you find there is a high risk behavior of a patient, like she is a sex worker or having multiple sexual partner, then repeat testing can also be done in pregnancy. So this part is important, because in some questions, you know, this part from this line also you get question. And if the patients like who comes in labor and there had been no testing done, and then in that particular situation they do rapid HIV testing, and rapid HIV testing takes 20 minutes to perform. Okay, so these are some fourth generation tests are there. So these are the rapid HIV testing. So this knowledge is also from strategy. Now about the HIV, so many psychological things are there. So whenever usually the woman with the HIV is always taken care by MGT. So this MGT people who are would be in HIV MGT, this you people have to know, it's important to know, because part three people have to explain this in their station answer. And part two people direct question can come. Just read it. I'm going it through once. So you'll be, the things will stick into your head. No need to remember so much. Okay. So what will be the main team? There will be HIV specialist or HIV physician. Obstetrician has to be there. There would be an specialist midwife, pediatrician, women's GP, and health visitor. So this is the main team. But what other people can be in HIV MDT? So they could be patient advocates who can take decision on her behalf. There would be social workers. There would be clinical psychologists and psychiatrists, counselors, health advisors, citizen advice bureau workers, interpreters, community midwives, pharmacists, adult pediatric clinical nurse specialist. So just go through this once, but main team whosoever is there, that you should know. Now you will get question from this part, you know, and many time I have even seen SBAs from here. So this is new in this guideline. Previously it was not there because of the so much of psychological issues associated with HIV. So they have got a depression. So in this new guideline, what they wrote is incidence of depression in a woman with HIV is 30 to 55 53%. This number is from this new guideline only. Have not seen any question from this number, but you know, just you can see it for a once time. Therefore, these women, they are at a risk of antenatal depression as well as postnatal depression. So there would be risk assessment, mental health risk assessment should be done 3 times in whole pregnancy. Okay. And you will get direct question from this. So you have to remember it. At booking, when the woman is coming at the first time, 4 to 6 weeks postpartum and 3 to 4 months after postpartum. So you have to remember this, because you would get question from these lines. So how many times depression assessment has to be done? Okay. And how it is done? It is done from the Woolley's question. And you know, in this postnatal mental health guideline, they have given Woolley's question. So you have to know Woolley's question also, because I have seen question from this only Woolley's questionnaire. So question number one, during last month, have you been bothered by feeling low down and depressed? Second question, last month, have you been bothered by taking less interest or pleasure in doing thing? If the woman says yes, then in that situation, you have to ask another question. But these are the two famous questions. Part three people, they know it very well, because in all stations they are asking this. But in part two, they will ask the name of this question, and this is Woolley's. just to show you this, I have put this slide, though it is not in mental health class. Now, you will get a question from this part also. It is important to know for part two people and part three as well. Sometime you will find a role player station and you have to break a news that she has HIV positive. Now she will say that I don't want to tell it to my partner. In that situation, her partner is at risk of getting HIV if she is not disclosing. Okay, so your part, your job will be to counsel this woman that she should explain this to her partner, because having sex with her partner without giving him knowledge that she has become HIV positive will put her partner at risk. So now in this situation, there would be a conflict between a doctor and also between a patient. So doctor wants, as a doctor, we have a duty of confidentiality to the patient, and also we have got duty that there should be no harm to other person also. But this patient, if she is not willing, in that particular situation, this is one of the situation where you can break confidentiality. So breaking confidentiality in order to inform sexual partner if the patient has come positive is sanctioned as a last resort by WHO. So in part two people, you will find question, and part three, you will find this directly in the role player station. So you can break confidentiality in this particular situation if you find this woman's husband or partner, he is at a risk of getting HIV infection. Either she will tell, you will counsel her, otherwise you will break confidentiality. Okay, so this is one of the example, and on all these lines I have taken directly from guideline. Okay, is it clear about confidentiality thing in this stage, in this course, in this part?
Ma'am, can you repeat this?
Okay.
Breaking confidentiality.
Okay, so I would give you an example. There had, you are a doctor and a patient has come and her test has come positive. You are the doctor who are breaking the news to her. Your test has come positive. And then in that particular situation, it will be your duty to tell her that it is an HIV is an STD, and she has to tell that to her partner. And if she doesn't tell, then, you know, he will be at risk. Patient will say, no, he will leave me, and, you know, that will spoil my married life. I will not tell my husband. In that particular situation, you have to overrule this law of confidentiality, because there is a conflict between you and your patient. But because of this, she is not telling it to her husband. So she is putting her husband at risk of getting HIV. So if you will tell her, you will counsel her, if she doesn't agree, then for the safety of her husband, you will break confidentiality. Then it will be your duty to break confidentiality and to get her husband or partner know that she has become HIV positive. So this type of scenario will come in part two question also, and in part three also. Is it clear now?
Yes.
Usually as a clinician, we cannot tell anything about our patient to any other person. Okay. But this is one of the situation we can break confidentiality. These all lines are from guideline.
Now, excuse me, ma'am. Yes, Dr. Yes. What does it say to the, as a role player, if the patient is there and she doesn't want to inform her husband, then what will he say, that we are going to involve some other social workers who will help in informing the partner?
So in that, okay, so in that situation, you will say, see, as a clinician, I do have duty of confidentiality towards you. But if you are not able to tell your husband, then in that situation, your husband is at risk. So we have got counselors, we have got a trained health advisors. So in this particular situation, we have to break this confidentiality, and we have to let your partner know about your status. So this way you will say.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay. Now, whenever the patient, she gets HIV positive, or in that situation, STD screening has to be done. And if this patient, like, there will be two situations. Patient is pregnant and all of a sudden her test has come positive. So she is positive for one STD. So you have to do all other STD screening. This is situation number one. When the patient has newly become HIV positive, but there is another patient who she is already HIV positive. She is known HIV positive and she has become pregnant. So for those patients also that were previously HIV positive, so a sexual health STD screening has to be done. Okay, so it is important to do STD screening. Either she is previously known HIV positive or she has newly become HIV positive. In both of the scenario, STD screening has to be done. Okay, the number that was written in the guideline, STD incidence in the woman living with HIV is 0 to 4%, and also association of bacterial vaginosis with HIV is 1 to 4%. I have just put this number, just listen them once, no need to remember because I have not seen ever question from this. Okay, just remember that STD screening is important for these women, because if one risk STD is there, maybe another test may also come positive. You will get question from here also. Now, coming to investigation. So whenever a patient becomes newly positive, okay, then special kind of tests are not required. So her test will be same as we do for any other antenatal woman, but liver function test has to be done if CART is commenced during pregnancy. And why it is important to do liver function test, because these are hepatotoxic drugs. So there could be possibility they will affect liver. So you have to also find out whether it is because of this CART or any other associated obstetric complications such as obstetric cholestasis, preeclampsia, HELLP, or acute fatty liver. Any other syndromes are there, because all of these are obstetric complications. They will affect liver. So it is important to monitor and their liver function test. So when it will be done? It will be done routinely when the initiation of CART is done, and whenever patient is having routine blood test. So with routine initiation or any routine blood test, LFT will be done. Okay, so this is important because these are hepatotoxic drugs. Now you will find question from this slide. A number of questions will be there for part two. And part three people also have to know, because if the role player comes, she is HIV positive. So you have to tell when all the tests will be done. Now there will be two situations. This is the patient already, she is HIV positive. Okay. And she has become positive. She has become pregnant. Now we already know this virus, it affects CD4 lymphocytes. So usually because of this infection, there will be fall in CD4 count. Okay. So we have to know how much is the CD4 count. So we are doing CD4 count two times. Just remember this. We are doing CD4 count two times. So if the patient is previously positive, now she has become pregnant. So we will do just a baseline and one before delivery. Okay. So two times CD4 count is done. Now, if the patient has newly become diagnosed as a HIV positive, then also we are doing CD4 count two times. Okay, so we are doing when we started this at the initiation of treatment as a baseline and also at the delivery. So it will be easy to remember that CD4 count will be done only two times. it will be at baseline or at the initiation of treatment and delivery. Okay, so just remember about this, about CD4 count, but about the viral load, you have to remember this thing, and because you will get question from this, and you have to remember, you know, because for part two people, question come from this line, and for part three people, they have to explain it to role player. Or if the viral station comes, then also they have to tell how many times viral load testing will be done in newly diagnosed women. Okay, if the woman is already on cart, so viral load testing will be done at 36 weeks, because they have to then decide on the basis of viral load, what will be the mode of delivery. But for the newly based woman, so this is the schedule for viral load testing. So when we start treatment, it will take 2 to 4 weeks for this drug to become effective and viral load to come down. So whether the treatment is working or not, so we'll be doing viral load testing 2 to 4 weeks after we start CAR treatment, number one. Number two, at least every trimester we have to do how the patient is responding to the treatment. 36 weeks we always do. Why? Because we have to decide the mode of delivery. And one, we will do at delivery. When the patient has about to has come to labor, at the delivery also we will do. So just, I'm repeating it again. So the CD4 count will be done 2 times, whether the woman is on previously HIV positive or newly diagnosed. So it will be done one baseline and one at the delivery. So it is simple remembering CD4 count, but viral load has to be done for newly diagnosed women. It will be 2 to 4 weeks after the treatment has been started. Then every trimester, then at 36 weeks and at delivery. This you have to remember, because you will get question from this, this lines, you will get direct question. Is it clear about the CD4 and viral load testing?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, this is not too much of concern, but at least you have to know. So whenever, you know, they're starting treatment, usually they do HIV resistance testing. And so HIV resistance testing is done and results will be there before the treatment is started. But in case the patient is coming late after 28 weeks of pregnancy, so without HIV resistance testing, they will be starting this medication. Maybe sometime they will ask question from here. And also in previous guideline, they have whether they used to stop CART after delivery in old guideline 2014. But in this new guideline, once the CART is started, it will be lifelong. So no one, even the whole postpartum, they have period, they have to take this the CART treatment. But anyhow, if a woman choose, she doesn't want to continue or any issues are there, in that situation also resistance testing will be done. Why? To see whether any mutation has been there that should not be missed when the patient has gone off treatment. So I have never seen question too much from here, but only this much you have to know about this HIV resistance testing. And another, maybe sometime any question come from here that why, what will be the reasons that viral load is not getting down or less than 50. So these are the few possible reasons. Like patient is not taking complete medication, so we have to see her adherence. There could be a resistance, so we have to do resistance testing. We can consider for therapeutic TDM or therapeutic drug monitoring, whether she is maintaining drug levels or not. Maybe regimen has to be changed, or maybe more intensification has to be done. Okay, maybe you may get question, or this does not look too much important. Now, a few things you have to know about CART. So in CART, there are four type of medications they are used. CART is combined antiretroviral therapy, and there are different medication what we are using, medications what we are using. So these are the these groups of medication. So these are NRTI. These are nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors. These are NNRTI. These are non-nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors, and PI, protease inhibitors, and integrase inhibitors. No need to remember anything. Nobody is going to ask you this question. Just for understanding, I have put it that you should have an idea, you know, not for the exam, for general knowledge also. So these are the four group of medication. And usually what happens when the they make a regimen, usually there will be two drugs from the NRTI group. So they will form the backbone of a CART regimen, and one will be either from NRTI or either from protease inhibitor. This way, this combined antiretroviral therapy treatment is made, okay? But according to the various situations, some drug can come from here and some drug can come from here. This much initial information is required to understand the thing. So again, what are NRTI? No need to remember anything, just remember. So what are the medication that comes in this group? So it will be lamivudine, ziduvudine, abacavir, and tricetabine. Okay, so whenever you will see many regimes, you will find these are the basic drugs we'll use. NRTI usually forms the backbone of CART. So you will find two drugs from this. Okay, there will be two drugs from NRTI group. Now NNRTI, so these are the medication. Usually you will find nevirapine or efavirenz from this group. Though there are so many things, but you need not to remember anything. Just basic knowledge. Then what are the integrase inhibitor? Dolutegravir and raltegravir. So these are integrase inhibitor, okay? So you will find these medications like raltegravir when the patient is coming late in the liver, presenter in the liver, and you have to add fourth drug, then this will come in the picture, raltegravir, okay? But I have never seen so many questions from name. So don't get confused and need not to remember this name. This is just for understanding. Protease inhibitor, we will find lopinavir boost or ritonavir boost. So these are protease inhibitor. So these are the four groups of CART. Now, there had been some update. This is 2020 update about the CART in pregnancy. So I will only highlight the few things that is important and from where the question will come. So this is an update. So it is recommended if the patient conceiving on effective CART, she should continue the treatment. So what they are saying, if the patient is on CART, she is taking some treatment, this will continue. But there could be few things that you have to remember. Like if she is taking non-standard treatment, that means she is taking only one drug. You have to change it, okay? Then if the patient is planning for the pregnancy and she is taking this dolutegravir, okay? If she is taking this medication, then you have few things it is important that you should know about this drug. Maybe you get question, or maybe you have to speak in the role player station. If she's on this medication, with this medication there is incidence or evidence of neural tube defect, okay? So if the patient is taking this dolutegravir and they are trying to conceive or they are in the first trimester, then high dose of folic acid 5 milligram has to be added, okay? So just remember this much information about this medication. Apart from this medication, whatever the medication they are taking, they will take standard dose of folic acid, that is 400 microgram, before they can start it before pregnancy, and they will continue it till 12 weeks of gestation or first trimester, that we already know. So what you have to remember from this slide is only two things. If the patient is on standard treatment of CART, she will continue same treatment. Second, if your patient is on this medication, dolutegravir, so if the patient is on this medication, if you find this name in your question, then you have to bring in the picture about, you have to be aware that there could be possibility of associated neural tube defect. So you have to add a high dose folic acid, that is 5 milligram. This point they have added this in this new 2020 interim update. So this part with the yellow marks has become important for part two and part three. Both people, you have to now remember this, because whenever they update a guideline or put some update, usually that becomes the source of questions. Now these are the recommendation. So now these are the recommended treatment, antiviral treatment in pregnancy. So now you will see there will be two drugs from NRTI group, whatever I have spoken before. This will form the backbone. So these are the recommended medication. And third drug will be from REST3 group. Either it will be NNRTI, protease inhibitor, or integrase inhibitor. So this is again NNRTI. So this is CART. Two drugs from NRTI group and one drug from NNRTI group. There are so many drugs, no need to remember anything, because nobody will going to ask you names of drug. It is so you need not to remember, just whatever the highlighted portion, that only you have to know. Is it clear about the drugs? Very less knowledge is required though. Any question about these drugs? Any question about the drugs?
Yes, ma'am. You are thinking dolutegravir should be started after 6 weeks of gestation, but it is causing neural tube defect. So can we start?
I will tell you. Yeah. See, if there could be two things. If the patient is already taking it, so in that particular situation, you have to tell patient about risk of neural tube defects. Apart from this, you have to add 5 milligram of folic acid. But there will be second situation. You have to start the medication. It is required. Then if you have to start this medication, you will start after 6 weeks. Okay, why? Because according to them, or we already know, neural tube will be closed by 4 weeks. Okay, in this guideline, they have written neural tube will close by 6 weeks. So after 6 weeks, if you have to start dolutegravir, you can start. So this they have written in the guideline. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. And another thing, yellow thing you will see in the upper box, this part also, it is important, you know, maybe ask sometime. If your patient is taking tenofovir, she is taking, in that particular situation, you will usually start this after first trimester. Okay. Main important is to remember dolutegravir, because it has got association with neural tube defect. Anytime if you have to start, you can start after 6 weeks of pregnancy. This little information is enough for your exam purpose. Please don't remember all these names. This is so difficult. No one can remember it. Is it clear now what the question you asked?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, according to this new guideline, all of the women who start during pregnancy, they will continue treatment lifelong. Okay. In previous guideline, they have to do viral load and CD4 count, and they are able to stop it. But this is changed in this new guideline. They have to, if the treatment is started during pregnancy, they have to continue lifelong. Please remember it. This is a new point in the guideline. Apart from this, you have to know what are elite controller. Elite controllers are a group of patients. They have undetectable viral load, and also they have got high CD4 count, and they're not on any kind of treatment. So these are these type of patients. They have got like no risk because they have got undetectable viral load and very high CD4 count. So their immune system is good, and they are not on any kind of medication. So these are elite controller. Just to understand, no, never question come from this elite controllers. Now this part is really important for both of the part 2 and part 3 people. You have to remember this by heart. So this is of the picture of guideline. This I have just put in summary. So now if the patient has become HIV positive and you have to start CART, so when you will start it? Okay. So, you know, if the viral load is high, you will try to start it early. So if it is more than 1 lakh, okay, more viral load more than 1 lakh and CD4 count is less than 200, that means this is a very sort of a high risky patient, please start it early. So you will start CART in first trimester. Okay, so I have summarized it so that the remembering becomes easy, but it is same what they have put in the box, they have put in the guideline. So high viral load of 1 lakh, CD4 count less than 200, please start in first trimester. Now viral load is little less, like it is in between 30,000 to 1 lakh. You can start in the start during the initial part or starting of second trimester. But your patient is less risky and viral load is less than 30,000. You can relax and you can start late or anytime in second trimester. So I have just put them in a chronological order so that remembering becomes easy, because you will get question from here. And all of the women by 24 weeks, CART should be started. I'm repeating this again. When to start CART in HIV positive women. So just remember, higher risky is the woman, more early you will start. So if the patient's viral load is more than 1 lakh, CD4 count is less than 200, please start early in first trimester. But if it is little less, that means her viral load is in between 30,000 to 1 lakh, you can start in at the initial part or beginning of second trimester. If it is less than 30,000, you can start in second trimester. And all of the women, at least by 24 weeks, their CART treatment should be started. Is it clear? You will get question from this slide, a lot of questions. Is it clear? Any question? Any question? No question. Okay. Now, this is also important. This has been an update. What is the yellow? I have put it here is an update. If the late presenting woman in the liver, you will get question in the exam about this part. So if the late presenting woman in the labor and viral load is either you don't know or if it is more, in that particular situation, 3 or 4 drug regime has to be started. Like usually in CART, we give 3 drugs. Now you know it, but if the woman viral load is very high and if you don't know anything, then in that particular situation, you will consider either 3 or 4 drug, and of them 3 to 4 drug, one will be Reltigravir 400 milligram BD. This they have newly added. Or dolutegravir 50 milligram OD. Okay, So this will be the fourth drug added. And this is this dolutegravir 50 milligram. This is a new update from 2020. So no, just remember it on, see, read it once. That will stick into head. So these are the four drugs. What are the four drugs? So all of the women, they should be given strat dose of nivirapine 200 milligram. Why we give it? Because with the strat dose, it has got a like highly good, very good placental transfer. So there will be a good amount reach already in the baby. Okay. Therefore, they give strat dose of nivirapine 200 milligram. Then usually zidovudine and lambudine, it will be there. Apart from this, we know we have to give fourth drug also. So fourth drug will be either raltegravir or it will be dolutegravir. Okay. So this will be the fourth drug. And she is a late presenter. You don't know anything. High risky patient. So apart from this, during labor, you will start IV zidovudine also. You will get question from this slide. You have to understand and also you have to remember it also. So I'm repeating, if the late presenter woman is coming or you don't know about the viral load or it is very high, more than 1 lakh. So four drug regimen will be there. One will be stat dose of nivirapine 200 milligram. Zidovudine, lambudine, everyone will remember. Fourth drug will be either raltegravir 400 milligram BD or it could be dolutegravir 50 milligram plus IV zidovudine for the duration of labor. Is this thing clear? Because you will get question from here, both in part two and part three, people will be asked in Viva, because this can come as a Viva also. Any question with this slide? Any question?
This is me, Dr. Sayakam. I would like to know that you told that if it is untreated and viral load is very high, so in labor, so we do know the viral load, that it is unknown, you told, but how will start this all drug? We know it is untreated and came in labor, so we didn't. That means if it is unknown, even though we'll start all these drugs?
No. Okay. Oh, I'll give question to you, answer to your question. So if you would, in the initial part, I already told you that when the woman comes in labor, they do rapid test. Rapid test result comes within 20 minutes. Okay. So rapid test, they will get to know this patient is HIV positive. But they will not know her viral load. So they can give her drug because they don't know it. This is the line. See, if the viral load is unknown, you don't know it or it is very high. In these two conditions, 3 to 4 drug regimen will be started. Is it clear, Salma?
Yeah. But you wrote up that raltegravir and the dolutegravir. That means it will be included also.
See, there will be four drug. One drug will be nivirapine 200 milligram. Second will be zidovudine and lambudine. Fourth drug will be either raltegravir or dolutegravir. This will be one of the two. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So for part three, people, at least you have to know that you will give four drugs and just remember that one will be nivirapine and another will be either any one of them. If you don't, part three people, if they don't remember dose, there will be no issue. But you have to minimum this thing you have to tell. Okay. Okay. So whenever any preterm is coming and in that particular situation, to the mother, they give a double dose tenofovir. Why? Because preterm babies, they won't be able to absorb oral medication. So loading is done, double dose is given to mother, so they will be loaded when they are born. Okay, you may get question from this. Now this part I have already explained. and it is you have to remember because this is new in the guideline.
Stopping ma'am, why double dose?
Why double dose? Because you know, if the preterm, if the mother is positive, so there could be possibility baby can also be positive. And in the babies, usually we start treatment, okay, either zitovudine or it is triple therapy CART. But if the term baby are there, they can take oral medication. But this preterm baby, they cannot take oral medication. So if the double dose is given just delivery to mother, that will help transplacental transfer. So this preterm baby will be getting this medication. Therefore, double dose tenofovir DFA is given. Is it clear?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, please repeat this point. There was a poor internet connection, so I missed this, ma'am.
Okay, so okay, this part will come in details in next upcoming slides also. So if a preterm patient is there, in that particular situation during labor, you give double dose tenofovir DF. This why you give it? Because preterm baby, they won't be able to take oral medication. So double dose is given just before birth to mother or when the patient is admitted. Why? Because it will cause a transplacental transfer. So baby will be loaded with the medication.
So ma'am, like the four medicines we are... Hello?
Yeah.
Ma'am, the four medicines that zidovudine, lamivudine, nevirapine and raltegravir we are giving, along with that we have to give this medicine?
No,
double
this
dose
is
in preterm?
No. This is all about this is not about preterm, this is a term patient. This if patient is preterm, then only this additional medication is added
for okay ma'am. So only, in the patient, yes ma'am, so we have to, we don't have to give that four medicine in preterm patient, only tenofovir
this we have to give, but we don't know. See, preterm, we don't know whether the patient is already booked patient, she is on card, she is taking she has come new, so that status we don't know. This part is this four drug regimen is there. If patient you don't know anything about the patient, you don't know anything about the viral load there, then a patient has come all of a sudden in labor, then you will give this four drug. Okay.
Yeah, but, this I got, huh? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, but if you find preterm, so in preterm they will change something in medication. So at least this double dose tenofovir will be there apart from any other medication to load them.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And like this part I have already explained, in postpartum, if the AR CART is started during pregnancy, so she has to take lifelong treatment. It will not be stopped anytime in postpartum. So this is a change. You have to remember this. So now you will get question about this also. So if the hepatitis B infection is there with HIV, or if hepatitis C infection is there with HIV. So now coming to B infection. So if co-infection is there, then you have to do some test. You will get question from there. And these are the tests done. What are the tests you want to do? So you have to do the testing for HBV DNA. Okay, so how much load of hepatitis B virus is there. You have to do E antigen, because E antigen in hepatitis B is a marker for replication. So you have to do E antigen, and you have to do other hepatitis testing, that is ACD. Okay, apart from this liver function. So you will get a question in the exam. So you need to know if the patient with HIV, but now the hepatitis B has come positive. So these are the tests you have to do, and it is important, you know, you may get this question in the exam. So you will test for viral load of HBV DNA. You will do E antigen testing, hepatitis A testing, HAV testing, hepatitis C testing, HCV, and HDV, hepatitis D testing. So if the one viral infection have come positive, you will do testing for others as well. Apart from this, you will do liver function testing as a baseline. And when you will start treatment with for HBV, then repeat testing will be done 2 to 4 weeks after, because you have to find out how the response, liver response is there when the drug has been started. Okay, so LFT is done, will be done at the initiation and in 2 to 4 weeks after the ART, because these are hepatotoxic drugs also. This we have discussed before also. Now this part is also important. So if any patient becomes positive with hepatitis B virus, usually tenofovir DF is given as a treatment. So now if the patient is already on CART, so you have a review of her CART treatment will be done. So they will change it, so at least it will come in the their CART. For example, if they are taking zidovudine, lamivudine, and efavirenz, so this type of patient was there, and it has now she has become HIV, hepatitis B positive. So her treatment will change, because you have to bring this in their treatment also. This so now you can see, if tenofovir DF is currently not the part of CART, it should be added. So this part you have to remember. That much is enough. Not more than that is not required. Just remember this. Another important thing you have to remember is this. So if the patient is HIV, hepatitis B positive, then and you will do, you have already done testing for hepatitis A. So if your patient is non-immune for hepatitis A, then please do vaccination. Vaccination will be for hepatitis A. It will be done 0 and 6 months. But if your patient CD4 count is less than 300, then you have to do give 3 doses of hepatitis A, 0 month, 1 month, and 6 month. This much information you have to know about this vaccination and tenofovir DF if co-infection is there. Is it clear or any question? Any question about this? Any question?
Excuse me, Dr. Jethral,
Yes.
That previous slide, can you explain the previous slide, that one? Sorry, I missed a little bit. The previous
Tenofovir?
Not this one, previous slide.
This one?
Yes. Is it previous one? Yes, please.
Okay, so if the patient is HIV positive, but all of a sudden her hepatitis B test has come positive. So as a part of your duty, you have to do some additional test. So you have, it is important to know whether, what is the viral load for hepatitis B. So you will do HBV DNA, number one. And you will do E antigen. Why you will do E antigen? Because E antigen is marker for viral infection, viral replication. So you will do 2 tests for hepatitis B to know that how much this patient is affected. Apart from this, you will do tests for other virus also, that is A, C, and D. Okay. So whenever new infection is there, you will do 2 tests for hepatitis B, that is DNA and E antigen. You will do all other ACD virus test plus LFT you will do. Okay. This is what you're asking.
Yeah. LFT, this one I want to know that. So LFT will do 2 and 4 weeks after commencing.
Yes, that you have to do to know whether the drug is working or not, or whether this drug is hepatotoxic or not, you know. So that you have to check. Okay, so this I'm repeating it again. So in the treatment, you have to make it sure that TENO4VDF should be the part of CART. If it is not already there, you have to, you know, it has to be added. And if the patient is non-immune for hepatitis A, then vaccination you have to be done. So it is 0 and 6 month, two doses are given. But if your patient CD4 count is less than 300, that means patient is quite sick, immunity is less. So you will give three doses, 0, 1, 0, 1 and 6 month. Okay, so this is all you have to know about hepatitis B. Now this part, okay. So if you have started CART, so it will continue through whole postpartum. This we are repeating again and again. Apart from this, during postpartum, hepatitis flares can be there. So you have to keep eye on the patient because hepatitis failure can be there. Flares can be there, and you have to kind of be very attentive. And if any flare is there, you have to be careful and do testing. You will get question from this, and this will come in part two and part three exam both. So if the patient has, if the baby is delivered, so usually if hepatitis B is positive, then no issue, there will be vaginal birth for the patient. So when the vaginal birth is there and the baby is born, so usually in case of, if the mother is hepatitis B positive, then usually we give both active and passive immunization to the baby. So we give both hepatitis B and hepatitis B immunoglobulin also. So we already know this, but again, some revision. Rate of trans, this percentages you have to remember. And for both two and three people, and these percentages are from a BIVA guideline, okay? So rate of transmission for hepatitis B, if hepatitis S and E antigen is there, it is 70 to 90%. Now you can just understand that E is a marker of replication. That means virus is quite active in the body. If only surface antigen is positive, then rate of transmission is 10 to 40%. And if the treatment is given, the hepatitis B and HBG, so if this treatment is given, then reduction is done, and reduction is done by 0 to 14%, okay? So I have seen a question from above two percentages. So please remember it, you have to, because you can get question from this part also. Apart from this, I have seen question from this part also. So when I was preparing for my exam, I searched so much for this, this from where to get answer. So from some UK website, I got it, but now they have put in the BIVA guideline. What are the indications of giving hepatitis B immunoglobulin to the neonate? This you have to remember, because this will you will get question from here. Okay, if the mother's DNA hepatitis B DNA concentration is more than 10^6, if she is E antigen positive, or if antibody to E antigen is not there, or if antibody to E antigen is negative, that means a virus in a replication state. Okay, so these are the four indications where you will give hepatitis B immunoglobulin to the baby. I have seen this question, and you have to remember this. So this part is important for both two and three people, because you will get, you may get station in part three, where you are explaining that hepatitis B is positive and how you will manage this new her baby to the role player. So you have to remember this. And part hepatitis B station has already appeared in the RCOG course. So is the thing clear about neonatal management if the mother is hepatitis B positive? Any questions about that? Only this much you need to know. Any question? Any question?
No question. Thank you.
Okay, only one thing you guys have to know about hepatitis C infection. I have not put so much about it. So whenever the hepatitis C new infection is there, so now it is the same. You will do test confirmation of HCV viremia. So there will be testing for HCV apart from this liver function test. Okay, and once the treatment is started, LFT will be repeated after 2 to 4 hours. 2 to 4 weeks. So this part is same. Okay, so nothing to remember. Now, treatment of choice for hepatitis C. What is the treatment usually given? It is ribavirin, but this ribavirin is contraindicated in pregnancy. So if your patient is on ribavirin and she got pregnant, so she has to stop this medication. Okay. And what they say, if a woman of childbearing age is there and she is hepatitis C positive, so ideally she should be treated first and via ribavirin or directly acting antiviral therapies. Okay. And once her HCV becomes negative, then only she should plan for pregnancy, because ribavirin is not given during pregnancy. Or any other patient who find herself pregnant, she should discontinue this HCV therapy immediately. So this part is important for both 2 and 3 people. Okay. Apart from this, initially we do all virus testing. So we will do testing. We will do testing for hepatitis B also. And if the patient is non-immune, then hepatitis B vaccination will be given. Okay. Now you can just see, and also hepatitis A vaccination if the patient is non-immune. This part is same what we did for hepatitis B when we were doing treatment for hepatitis B. Now you just need to know, for hepatitis C, in summary, if she becomes pregnant, we cannot give any treatment. She has to stop ribavirin, number one. Number two, if the patient is non-immune for hepatitis B infection, so please vaccinate her and do vaccination after first trimester. Apart from this, if she is non-immune for hepatitis A, please do vaccination. So this part is same. Okay, it will be 2 doses, 0 and 6 months. But if CD4 count is less, then it will be 0, 1 and 6 months. Okay, so this much minimum information you guys need to know for HCV infection during pregnancy when the woman is HIV positive. Apart from this you have to remember, that if the patient is HCV positive and HIV positive, she can go for vaginal birth. This has been changed in this new guideline. If you do questions from old books, you will find if the HIV patient hepatitis C comes positive. So in previous guideline leaflets, you will find that was an indication for cesarean section. But this part has been removed in this guideline. So guys, please don't make this mistake, because you will do question from all books and you may get confused. So this is an update in this guideline. If the patient is HIV and HCV positive, answer will be vaginal birth. She can go for vaginal birth. Even in the hepatitis C station also, when we do, so we have to change our answer, that she is not candidate for vaginal birth. So whatever will be the HCV load, regardless of that, vaginal birth will be an option answer for that question. Don't make mistake in that. And she will continue CART throughout postpartum, because irrespective of viral load or fibrosis. In previous guideline, they have given some viral load. According to that, she can stop postpartum CART, But in this new guideline, they have stopped this. So for you people, the things have become easy. So whenever the cart is started during pregnancy, she has to continue postpartum and she has to continue lifelong. So for you people, the things are a bit easy in this this part. You need not to remember so many CD4 counts. So that's all you have to know about HCV. Any one of you have to any question about HCV in HIV pregnant patients? So before I move ahead, you can ask me. Any question about HCV? Okay, no question. Good. Okay, now what obstetric management in HIV positive patients. So few things you have to remember, even you know these screening tests we do. Okay, so screening test, few changes can occur if the patient is taking this medications. Like for example, need not to remember this. Like if the patient is, there could be increased level of beta HCG and alpha fetoprotein and lower level of estriol if the patient is taking HIV treatment, in the patient with HIV, okay? And a reduction in beta HCG if she is taking protease inhibitor based or NNRTI drugs. So what is the take home message? You have to remember that in if all these markers are affected in HIV positive women, and if they are on the CAR treatment, that makes our quadruple testing like less effective. So in this patients, there will be an increased number of false positive a test will come. Okay, if the test will come positive, if this triple test will come positive, then most of the women, they will go for invasive testing. So much of hassle is there. So what the guideline says, preferred modality for the testing for this kind of patient is combined testing. Okay, so Pap A and nuchal translucency, it is unaltered on, not altered by HIV treatment or ART. So these are the preferred screening modality. So need not to remember what parameter will be increased or what parameter will be decreased. Only you have to remember this. Because of this situation, there could be increase in the false positive rate, increase in the invasive testing. To avoid that, Pap A and nuchal translucency, as they are unaltered, not affected by HIV infection and treatment. So this is a preferred screening. So this is the preferred screening modality. Okay, so this part you have to remember. This is new for me also. I got to know from the guideline and new knowledge. Is it clear? I think nothing much more is there. Okay, so now this is easy, not a new thing, you already know this. So if any invasive, if a patient is a candidate for any invasive testing, so you will do testing for viral load. So and until the viral load becomes less than 50, you will defer the testing. So it is important for part two people, because answer you will get in the question will be defer testing until the load becomes less than 50. Again, if you have if a patient like it is important that you have to do testing, and you cannot delay that procedure, then what you will do in that particular situation, you will give a single dose of nevirapine 2 to 4 hours before the procedure, and also raltegravir. So by giving raltegravir and giving single dose of nevirapine 2 to 4 days before the procedure, hours before the procedure, there will be suppression of viral load. Then the invasive testing can be done. Now, this is simple. ECV can only be offered if the viral load is less than 50. Now, this you will get question from here, and I have just tabulated it so that the things will become easy to remember. Usually, we already know they do viral load testing at 36 weeks. And why they do it at 36 weeks? Because they will decide what would be the mode of delivery. So if it is less than 50, then in their term, we call this as a undetectable viral load. So we are not worried. So this patient can go for vaginal birth. But if the viral load is in between 50 to 399, then there will be consideration for PLCS, that is pre-labor cesarean section. But if it is more than 400, then answer will be recommend pre-labor cesarean section. So because, you know, in their question, you will find same wordings in the answer, consider cesarean section or recommend cesarean section. Though after 50, they are doing cesarean only. But you have to know the terminology, what they wrote in the guideline, because answer will show the same thing. Okay, so you have to remember this. So at 36 weeks, less than 50, go for vaginal birth. From 50 to 399, consider PLCS. More than 400, you recommend PLCS or pre-labor cesarean section. VBAC, you already know, if she is more than 50, less than 50, vaginal birth, you can allow. Now you will find a question many times where you have to tell them time for cesarean section. So usually it is 38 to 39 weeks. Now they have given two things here. If the cesarean section is done only for the indication for prevention of vertical transmission, then it will be 38 and 39 weeks. But if they are doing cesarean section for any other obstetric indication, then in that particular situation, they will do it after 39 weeks. So usually this is the time of cesarean section. Is it clear? Though there is nothing too much of understand there. Any question with this till now?
Ma'am, last line, please.
So time of cesarean, usually it is 38 to 39 weeks. Okay, so usually, so for part three people, it is not very difficult. You will say after 38 weeks, there will be cesarean section. But as they have made two lines here, so part two people, it becomes important. You have to read in between lines. If the cesarean section is done only for prevention of vertical transmission, if they write this in the question, your answer will be in between 38 to 39 weeks. But they say pre-labor cesarean section is planned for obstetric indication. And for any other obstetric indication and viral load is less than 50, then you can say it after 39 weeks. I don't know what sense it makes, but you have to know this because, you know, your answer will change for part two people. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. This you have to like remember by heart, because this usually as if the part three station comes, patient from this part of the guideline, and it is really important for part two also. So if spontaneous rupture of membrane is, so I have summed up whatever they wrote is here. Okay, so if spontaneous rupture of membrane is there, so in that particular situation, you have to deliver this woman within 24 hours. Reason we already know, because it will increase further rate of transmission, and also there will be risk of chorioamnionitis. Okay, so we have to deliver this woman within 24 hours. Now, So what if the viral load is less than 50? We already know we can allow her for vaginal birth. So your answer will be immediate induction or augmentation of labor. Okay. And if apart from this 50, viral load is more than 50, either it is in between 50 to 399 or more than 400. So here, in both of the condition, answer is consider immediate cesarean section. So though you know everything, but you know, in your SBO or EMQ, you have to find out this word, recommend immediate cesarean section. Because recommend cesarean section, do immediate cesarean section, this won't be the answer. You have to look for same word, recommend immediate cesarean section. So this part is like important. So whenever rupture of membrane at term, please deliver within 24 hours. Viral load less than 50, you can allow vaginal birth. So please do immediate induction or augmentation. And if it is more than 50, okay, viral load, in that particular situation, you have to recommend immediate cesarean section. Is it clear? Okay, this is again important. So if subspontaneous rupture of membrane is there and your patient is in between 34 to 37 weeks of pregnancy, okay, in that situation, you have to, as the rupture of membrane is there, so you have to deliver this woman within 24 hours. Again, if you have to do the treatment according to viral load, if it is less than 50, you can go ahead with immediate induction or augmentation of labor. Any other condition, you have to go for, you have to recommend immediate cesarean section, plus only one addition will be there. For these patients, you have to start GBS prophylaxis, okay? So all the treatment is same of SORM, what we did here, okay? But as this patient is between 34 to 37 weeks, so this is a preterm patient. So in that particular situation, you have to add GBS prophylaxis in the answer also. Another situation, so your patient is less than 34 weeks and she has got a rupture of membrane. So what you will do? So these are the three things. So you have to speak these in the role player station, part three, Viva, and also in part two exam. So this, you will find combination of this thing. So you will consider giving her steroid. You will do optimization of viral load. You will, time and mode of delivery will be decided by MDT. So these three things you have to bring in the answer for part two people. You have to look for option where all three things are there. And also part three, you have to tell this to your examiner or role player. This rupture part of this guideline is important because you will get question from this part, okay? And how the optimization is done. So usually they will give oral nevirapine 2 hours before delivery, or they can give double dose tenofovir DF, or standard dose dalteglipron 400 BD before delivery. This part, now previously also there was a discussion that in preterm labor, why we were giving double dose tenofovir DF. Because, so as I have already given answer, preterm babies, they are not able to take oral medication. So before they are delivered, loading dose is given to their mother so that there will be, because of placenta transfer, so this baby will get all these medications. So these are the medications are given for optimization of viral load. Nevirapine 200 milligram more than 2 hours before delivery, and double dose tenofovir, and standard dose of dalteglipron 400 milligram BT. Okay, this part you have to remember.
Ma'am,
Yes.
Mom, we should give tenofovir and raltegravir irrespective of her card status, like what all medications you are taking or not.
I think yes. Though they have guideline the, has not. This is for preterm. Okay. This,
yes, ma'am, for so preterm.
Loading will done. Loading will be done for the baby. This is for to load baby.
Okay. Supposedly, if the patient is if the patient comes to us for the first time in preterm labor, like we know that the rapid card test is positive, we don't have any viral load status and all, then we won't give her zidobutane, lamivudine, all. We will only give her tenofovir or raltegravir.
No. If you don't know viral load, she is coming first time for the labor, then you will give her four drug regimen. In those that four drug regimen, raltegravir is already there.
So always there, yes. So we should have, we should add double dose of tenofovir extra.
Yes, I think yes. But
that should be five.
Guideline does not specify this, that if the patient is already taking, then we will give double dose tenofovir DF or not. In case of preterm, what they are saying, we have to give this to mother so that baby will be loaded.
Okay, matlab, that means we have to give it in addition. And ma'am, they have not mentioned anything about the antibiotics. They have said that less than 34 with strom, we have to give steroids, viral load, MDT. No mention of antibiotics.
But with that, we already know. No, the guideline doesn't mention that. Guideline doesn't mention that. But from our knowledge, we know that.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking. Okay, thank you.
Because I never wanted to put any extra word from, you know, any other guideline. I wanted to cover only BIVA. Therefore, I'm just, whatever I'm speaking is only from BIVA.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, so this part also is important. You will get question from this also. So what are the indications of giving IV zidovudine? So usually we give zidovudine, just in rough idea, you know, to remember this, use of intravenous zidovudine will be done if the patient already taking medication, but viral load is not suppressed. If it is less than 50, we are happy. But if it is not controlled, it is more than, it is in bit more than 50, or you can say it is in between 150 or 100. In that particular situation, regardless of mode of delivery, zidovudine IV should be given. Okay. So now these are three indications they mentioned in the guideline. So if the patient is in labor, either with a rupture of membrane or their cesarean section, any situation is there, but you find viral load is more, then 1000, please give IV zidovudine. If you find patient is on treatment, but suppression, complete suppression is not there, that means it is not less than 50, then also in that particular situation, you have to give IV zidovudine. And if any untreated woman is coming in the labor, then we are covering with IV zidovudine. So these are the three things, conditions where IV zidovudine is given. So this you have to remember. Basic thing what you will remember, if the viral load is not controlled, not less than 50, those are the situation you will give IV zidovudine. Now you will not get, this is just in they have, because I have to complete guideline. Usually place of birth will be in birth center and obstetric unit, where facilities for pediatric care will be there. And water birth, usually they do not have very enough evidence to support water birth in the woman with HIV. But what they are saying, like if the viral load is less than 50, then they can be supported to have water birth. This part is more important for part three people. So if your role player viral load is less than 50, she can go ahead with a water birth. You will say we have got little evidence to support it. But if it is more than 50, we will say no for water birth for your role player. So it is important. Now that's all about mother obstetric management. Now I'm moving to neonatal management. Any question till now? No question. Okay, neonatal management. In neonatal management, there has been updates in this 2020. So I will be telling you all updates. Usually for the neonatal treatment, they have divided this baby in three category. One is very low risk, another is low risk, another is high risk. So, and the treatment is different, you know, and you will get question from every part. So I have just summarized it. So when the neonate will be very low risk, if woman is on cart and she has taken in more than 10 weeks. So for example, if the cart is started 24 weeks and this patient is delivering at 36. So she has already taken 12 weeks of cart. So her baby will come low risk, or viral load is less than 50, we are very happy. Or two documented viral loads are there 4 weeks apart. We have got two, we should have two like documented evidence for this. So if these are the criteria, we can put baby under very low risk. Okay, I'm repeating it again. If mother has taken cart longer than 10 weeks, longer than 10 weeks, okay. Second, there are two, she has got two documented evidences of viral load less than 50. And at 36 weeks, viral load was done and it is less than 50. If the woman belongs to this category, a neonate will be put under a very low risk category. And what will be the treatment for baby? It will be zidovudine for 2 weeks. Okay, you will get question from this. And usually this treatment is started within 4 hours of birth. Okay, so this is the categorization for very low risk. Now coming to low risk. So what will be the categorization for low risk? Why you will put this neonate under low risk? If your all these criterias are not fulfilled, apart from this, baby has born less than 34 weeks. So this baby will go under the category of low risk. In low risk, this is the difference. Here, zidovudine, you are giving for 4 weeks. Just see here, very low risk, zidovudine for 2 weeks. Low risk, zidovudine for 4 weeks. So this is the difference, okay? Now coming to high risk. So high risk will be when the mother load is already more than 50. Neonate will become high risk. And high risk neonate, we give cart. That means she baby will get 3 medication and it has to be started within 4 weeks. So this is the change in this new guideline that was previously not there. So you have got no other option. You have to remember this. Now, this is the just a sum up. Very low, if the baby is under very low risk category, 2 weeks of zidovudine should be given. Very low risk. If the baby is under low risk, 4 weeks of zidovudine. If baby is under high risk, then 4 weeks of triple antiretroviral treatment will be given. That will include zidovudine, lamivudine, and nevirapine. And usually it should be started within 4 hours of birth. Okay, so this part I have already explained about what type of treatment has to be given. Now you will get question from this. I have already explained this. This premature babies, they cannot take oral treatment. Okay, therefore we are so much worried, we were loading mother. Apart from this, if we have to give treatment to this babies, preterm babies, so we have to give IV zidovudine. Okay, so be remember, you have to know this because you will get question from this part. Apart from this, why we are not getting giving this oral medications to preterm baby? So because they are at very high risk of necrotizing enterocolitis. Okay, so therefore IV zidovudine would be the treatment of choice or for preterm babies. Now, we know HIV has got two strain, one and two, though everything is the same, but in HIV 2, only one thing is different. HIV 2 is resistance to NNRTI. So if the CART is given, usually the drugs that belongs to NNRI category will not be given. Okay, because it is resistance. Only one line, I found it important to tell you guys. Now, this is an update from 2020. All these yellow things are update, okay? The newly added in 2020. So, usually we are giving this PEP for 4 weeks only. So, now, as you will find in UK, they say no to breastfeeding for HIV mother, and baby should be formula feed. But many times, some of the women, in spite of all this recommendation, they will choose to breastfeed the baby. So what the guideline says, so even if the baby is breastfeed and baby is coming under very low risk category, treatment will be for the baby, treatment will be for 2 weeks. And whatever will be the category, we are giving 2 weeks for low risk, very low risk baby, and 4 weeks for other babies. So even if the baby is breastfeed, treatment to baby will be same. So this part they have newly added into 2020 update. So this you have to know. So treatment for the baby will not change whether baby is breastfeed or whether the baby is formula feed. Okay, so this part you have to know. Apart from this, during breastfeeding, if a mother has mother's viral load becomes high, in that particular situation, what you will do to baby in that particular situation, advice will be taken from expert whether baby will require more treatment or not. Okay, so this part has been newly added in 2020. So is the thing clear? This part is clear, or I need to repeat or anything?
Ma'am, please repeat it.
Okay, so usually, as according to the categorization, very low risk baby gets treatment for 2 weeks, and other babies get treatment for 4 weeks. So in this guideline, what they have said, baby's treatment duration will be same. Either baby is breastfeeding or either the baby is bottle fed. So duration of PEP for baby will not change. Okay, this is one thing you have to remember. Second thing, if the patient is breastfeeding, so during breastfeeding, usually monthly testing is done. And sometime if the mother's test becomes very high, so baby will be at risk. In that particular situation, you have to give some treatment to baby also. So that advice you will take from expert. Now it is clear? Is it clear now? Is it clear? No question. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now this also you need to know that if the baby is HIV positive, then usually they are given pneumocystis pneumonia prophylaxis, and that is cotrimoxazole, and it is given when the baby is 1 month of age. Okay, so cotrimoxazole prophylaxis for pneumocystis carinii pneumonia will be done, but it will be given when the baby is 4 weeks or 1 month of age. Now, immunization. So immunization will be as per national schedule. Okay, there will be no change. Rotavirus, what they are saying, rotavirus vaccine is not contraindicated. Rotavirus vaccine is given, is a live vaccine, and it is given for diarrhea. Okay, so if the baby is HIV positive also, then rotavirus vaccine can be given. It is not contraindicated, But if the baby is severely immunocompromised, in that situation, that will be avoided, because we already know no live vaccine is given if the any patient is immunocompromised. Okay. If the baby is at, though BCG vaccine is given at the birth, and BCG vaccine is a live vaccine, we already know this, but if baby is coming under very low risk or low risk category, then BCG vaccine will not be delayed at all. Okay, this was the update about immunization. Only you need to know, but you know, never this, I have not seen any time question from this immunization part. This part is important, newly added in the guideline, and good to know also. Now, if the patients say, I will breastfeed my baby, so what are the factors that will risk HIV transmission? So these are the factors. You have to know this because you can get question from here. If detectable viral load in mother, that means more than 50. If very advanced disease, if longer duration of breastfeeding, most important, if nipple infection, any mastitis is there, or any mastitis to mom, or any gastroenteritis or gastric infection to baby. These are the situation where there will be very high risk of virus transmission. Usually we will ask mother to stop breastfeeding or to report immediately if she develops mastitis, or if she has got, if the baby develops diarrhea. In those two conditions, she has to stop breastfeeding for a while. And if mixed feeding is done, because if the solid food is given, then usually what the, you know, literature says, it causes some aberration inside the gut. And in that situation, if she baby is taking breast milk, so that will increase more chances of transmission. Okay, so these are the few things that will increase HIV transmission if the patient chose to breastfeed her baby. It is important, newly added in this guideline. Now, what happens in UK? In UK, they say UK is a high income setting country, and the safest way is to avoid breastfeeding and to give formula feed. So in the role player station, you know, they always ask this question, can I breastfeed my baby? So you have to give this answer. In UK, to avoid any transfer to baby from you, usually recommendation is not to breastfeed, okay? So if, and to give them formula milk, okay, formula feed. And in that particular situation, you have to suppress lactation, that will be given by cabergolin. Now, this if the woman says, no, I want to breastfeed my baby, in that situation, what you have to do? So breastfeeding, she can breastfeed if she has got, like she's taking her medication well, good adherence is there, and she has got very low viral load, okay, or undetectable viral load, but she has to agree for increased testing. What type of testing is done? It is done every month for mother and baby. Apart from this, 2 months after she had stopped breastfeeding. Okay, so this part you have to understand. Apart from this, these are the criteria to breastfeed, when she can breastfeed. If she has got fully suppressed viral load, if she has a good adherence history, that means she's a very good patient, she takes all medication, she is strongly engaged with perinatal MGT, okay, and she is ready for monthly clinic review and viral load testing. So these are the, if all these criteria are fulfilled, then she can be allowed to breastfeed her baby. Now, what some guidance for the woman, if she choose to breastfeed, it has to be exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. Okay, so there will be no solid food or any other thing should be given. It should be exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. Again, second line is really important, may come in the question also. Anytime if they have got mastitis or baby has diarrhea or gastroenteritis, they have to stop breastfeeding. You may get question from this line. even in the role player station also, if she says I want to breastfeed my baby, you have to give this advice as a safety advice to them. Okay, and whenever their viral, so they go for monthly testing. Anytime their viral load becomes high, in that situation they should be referred to social care, because baby will be at high risk. Okay, so these are the few things you know about, need to know about breastfeeding. Now this part is again updated in 2020. This you have to know. This you will get question from this type of testing. So now see, if the usually they keep test for the baby to keep eye on the baby. So if they are non-breastfeed babies, then HIV test is given. So this will be the schedule for HIV testing. Okay, so you have to remember it. It will be 2 days after birth, before she leaves hospital, 2 weeks, or if she's a high risk at delivery. This part, okay, this part has been newly added in 2020 update. So it is important you to know. So and at 6 weeks of age and at 12 weeks of age. So there will be HIV testing, and this testing will be HIV antigen testing. You have to remember this. For part three people, they should know this, but part two people have to remember this by heart, because you will get a question directly from there. Then, so these are antigen testing. Now they are doing antibody testing also. So this is again update in 2020, okay? So all yellow you can see. So when HIV antibody testing will be done? So whenever, if maternal status is not known, then whenever, whatever the first sample taken from the baby, anytime, okay, they will test for HIV antibodies. Why they are testing this? Because they will need to know whether HIV antibody has been transferred from mother to baby. So this will be from any first sample. Second sample for HIV antibodies will be taken 22 to 24 weeks. Okay, why? This was a change from the previous guideline. Previously, they were doing it at 18 weeks, but now they have changed it. So what they are saying, by 18 months of age, by 18, okay, if they tested before that, in that particular situation, there could be presence of maternal antibodies. And by this age, usually maternal antibodies will go. And if the antibodies are there, it will be from and that will be the marker for seroconversion. So they are seeing antibody testing at 22 to 24 weeks, because they want to check it for seroconversion. Okay, but that will mean that means that the testing is done at 24 weeks. So baby will be 6 months, but they want baby to be in follow-up care till 18 months of age. So this part, they have added new antibody testing. Previous guideline, it was not there. Is it clear about antibody testing in the baby?
Ma'am, as a whole test in baby, would you please reply? Repeat
what you're saying?
How to test infant, ma'am, totally as a whole in a shortcut? You can repeat it again.
Okay, I will repeating it again. If the baby is non-breastfeed baby, so there will be some HIV test. So there will be HIV testing. This is the schedule. 2 days after birth prior to hospital discharge. Then 2 weeks if baby belongs to high risk category at delivery. That we high risk category, I have already discussed. When the maternal viral load is more than 50, infant will be high risk category. So you will do their viral, their HIV testing at 2 weeks. Then you will again repeat at 6 weeks. Then you will again repeat at 12 weeks. So these are the schedule for HIV testing for non-breastfeed infants. Okay. Now, this testing you will be doing as only antigen testing. But now in the new update, they will be testing antibodies also. So what will be the schedule for antibody testing in non-breastfeed infant? Okay, so antibody test will be done any first sample from the baby if the maternal status is not known. So you are taking so many samples. So from first sample from the baby, you will check for maternal antibody status. Okay, if you don't know anything about mother, so you will check from first sample, number one. Number two, you will check HIV antibodies in the baby at 22 to 24 weeks, because you want to check whether baby has got seroconversion or not. So that will be done 20 to 24 weeks. So after this testing, you will not discharge this baby. You will keep under follow-up of care till baby is 18 months of age. Now, is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, now we are going to, this is appears, you know, I try to simplify the thing, but again, too much to remember, but you can't help it. You have to remember it. So breastfeed, now if patient says, no, I will breastfeed my baby. So there will be change in the testing. So HIV testing will be done. Now see, 2 days after birth, prior to hospital discharge, at 2 weeks and monthly till the breastfeeding. And once the breastfeeding stop, you will do two more tests, one at 4 weeks or 1 month after stopping breastfeeding, another at 8 weeks, 2 months after stopping of breastfeeding. Okay, so these are the schedule of tests if patient is breastfeeding. Okay, so this is the schedule. This is the schedule if the patient is breastfeeding. For the breastfeeding fed infants, this is the schedule. Okay, so HIV test will be done at 2 days prior to discharge, at 2 weeks, monthly till breastfeeding, after stopping breastfeeding, at 4 weeks, 8 weeks. Okay, then antibody testing. When the antibody testing will be done, so this part is this part is same. First sample antibody testing will be done from first sample when you take from the baby. Second will be 22 to 24 hours for seroconversion. This part is new. 8 weeks after cessation of breastfeeding. That means once the breastfeeding is stopped, at 2 months after that, you will again check for antibodies. So this is the schedule of HIV test if the baby is breastfed, and this is the schedule for HIV antibody testing if the baby is breastfed. So these are updates from 2020 that you have to remember, because you will get question from this new updates.
Is here, no, here, mom, here we should not do at 18 months.
No, in 18 months, they are keeping the baby for in under follow-up care. This is follow-up event. Okay. Here, they would follow the baby till all this testing is done, because you don't know when she will leave breastfeeding. So you cannot decide.
Okay, so it should be at least 8 weeks after cessation of breastfeeding. Okay, yes. Got it, ma'am. Thank you.
So this all the, yes.
Yes. In this, which is written in the, which you have enlightened with in yellow color, the HIV antibody testing for seroconversion should be checked at age 20 to 24 months. Okay, ma'am.
So what I wrote?
No. In the last third line, in the same slide we are discussing. There is written 20 to 24 weeks.
Okay.
Whether the seroconversion is 22 to 24 months or 20 to 24 weeks.
Okay, okay. Therefore, I was myself getting confused when I was teaching. Okay, this is a mistake. So it is not weeks, it is months. Okay, it is months.
Okay,
seroconversion is month. Both the time it is months, because I was myself thinking that it was previously also it was month. Okay, so
okay,
yeah,
after 2 years of seroconversion, then we have to follow up after 8 weeks of cessation of breastfeeding.
Yes, 8 weeks after cessation of breastfeeding. Yes, maybe.
Ma'am, because
if she
breastfeeding for six months only.
Yeah, so you will do 2 weeks after that, 8 weeks after that, then again you will do at 22 to 24 months also. Is it,
ma'am, will you please explain it again?
Okay, so see, if the patient is breastfeed, so this will be the schedule for HIV testing. Okay, 2 days prior to discharge, 2 weeks monthly till breastfeeding, and for 2 months after cessation of breastfeeding. Now for antibody testing, this is added new in the guideline. So first time you will test antibody whenever you are taking first sample. This is number one. Number two, you will test once she stops breastfeeding at second, after 2 months of stopping breastfeeding. Now you can see you are testing HIV antigen also after 2 weeks, after 2 months of breastfeeding. Even antibody also you are checking after 2 months. So this you can take in a single sample. Apart from this, this will depend on the duration when she stops breastfeeding. Apart from this, you will again test from 22 to 24 months. This is for seroconversion. Is it clear now?
Ma'am, exclusively breastfeeding is for 6 months. Okay.
But she can continue for long time also. You don't know. She will do breastfeeding for 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, 8 months. No idea.
Okay.
Okay.
Means if for 24 months she's breastfeeding, we wait for the HIV, and because the seroconversion takes place in 2 years. If
yes.
So after 2 years, we will have an antibody test. Then after cessation of the breastfeeding, we will have an antibody test after 8 weeks from last 2 years.
From, okay, don't get confused. So once she stops, anytime she stops breastfeeding, after 2 months, you have to do one antibody testing. Another antibody okay. testing you have to do at 22 to 24 weeks, months of age. That will help you in checking baby's seroconversion. Mm-hmm. What this new guideline says, by 18 months, whatever the antibody this baby is getting from mother, that will go away, that will vanish. And if the baby is having antibody test positive at 22 to 24 months of age, those antibodies will be the antibodies that are formed inside the body of the baby.
Baby, okay.
Now you are clear about this seroconversion thing?
Yes, ma'am.
Any question about this? Any question about this? No question, okay. So this is an update in 2020. Now, this is maybe you get question or maybe you get not. This is again update. So we are giving cotrimoxazole at 4 weeks, from the 4 weeks of age, if the baby is HIV positive. Second, if the baby is HIV positive, we are referring them to Children's HIV Association, okay? Apart from this, if the test in infant has come positive, then feedback should be sent back to obstetric unit also. So they will do some investigation. So this is also again an update. I don't know whether it is important or not, because, but it was a new edit, therefore I put it here. Again, this we have done before also. ART will continue in postpartum, and postnatal follow-up of the patient we will do at 4 to 6 weeks of after the baby, after delivery. So this is important when the patient should be called for postnatal follow-up. Usually we call them at 6 weeks, but in this guideline they wrote 4 to 6 weeks. Again, this is something important. So if the baby is HIV exposed but not infected, in that situation there should be timely routine vaccination, and care should of the baby should be taken by a GP, health visitor, and secondary care physician. They should be made aware of the this possibility. Like if the mother was positive but baby is not affected at all, in that situation we should make it made it sure that baby's care in the community will go well. So there should be timely vaccination, and all these people who are taking care in the community, they will be aware of this fact. Now, whenever a patient becomes positive, then her partner or her other children, they may be at positive. So in that situation, testing of her partner and other children has to be done. Okay, this is important because this part usually comes in part three station, when we say your partner and your other baby is also required to be tested, because they are also at the risk. Okay, so this is the last part of this. So this is all about this guideline with the 2020 update again with it. So any question you can ask, otherwise now I have put some question for you guys. Any question? Any question? No question. Okay, that means either I have done my job very good or very bad. Okay, so these are the questions for you. So see this, then this is the question. Okay, so should I show the options again?
Ma'am, please show the question again.
C D.
So she has attended at first week, first visit, antenatal visit. Okay, she has attended her first antenatal visit. So this is her booking visit. So answer will be now. Okay, now she's at booking only. Oh, these are same, but you are seeing it today and right now. So answer will be now, 4 to 6 weeks, 3 to 4 months. So this is the answer. Okay, so this is the question. read question, then I will show you options.
Oh, can you show the question again?
Why you are bringing code?
She is not disclosing it.
So what should be done?
Breaking.
First of all, we should try to counsel. Okay, it should be E.
Break confidentiality. This question I wanted right from you all. I just showed a big picture. Break confidentiality. Okay, her partner is at risk. Despite repeat attempts to discuss this with her partner, with whom she is having unprotected sexual intercourse, her partner at risk. Please do your job. Break confidentiality. Okay, please don't do this type of question wrong. These are the options.
A. O.
Yes, very good. A is the answer. So her viral loads are less than 50. So at 36 weeks, if the viral load is less than 50, vaginal delivery. So answer will be allow progress and anticipate vaginal delivery. Very good.
L.
Question again.
So her viral loads are 500. Okay. So if the viral load is more than 400, you have to recommend PLCS. So this is elective cesarean section at 30 to 39 weeks.
E, screen for STI, HIV resistance and liver function.
So what you are saying?
S.
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 Yes. So you have to screen for STI testing. You have to do HIV resistance testing, liver function test, and baseline CD4 count.
Viral load should be.
But viral load should be done after 2 to 4 weeks of ART. And she is now 1 week only. 1 week after commencing ART.
Yeah, so she will come after 2 weeks.
J.
Yeah, so it can be. J, ma'am, J.
It can be J. So viral load is repeated 2 to 4 weeks after ART. Then every trimester.
Altitude should be L.
Yes, answer should be L. Then
36 weeks and delivery.
So L is the complete answer. You know, your J is right, K is right, but yes, L is better.
L is complete.
So this is take home message when you do EMQ. If you find answer right, please look for other options also, because other option will be an answer. J and K both are right, but answer is L, because that is a complete answer. So this type of mistake is very common in EMQ. Be very careful for this kind of mistakes. You will, those who are marking J, they will say, oh, I have done right. Those who are marking K, they will also say, I have done right, but the answer will be L. So this we just read, that viral load has to be done 2 to 4 weeks after starting treatment, every trimester, 36 weeks and at delivery. You have to remember it by heart. There is no other option. Okay, I have to show you options. This new Justin Conji book, they give so much of options.
But do
ma'am, question again, please.
I thought I have done something wrong.
D, ma'am.
Hmm?
D.
What you are saying, D. No.
Immediate lower segment.
Immediate lower segment cesarean section.
R, ma'am.
At category 2 cesarean section.
Let me see. Immediate cesarean section. Okay. And there are certain concerns about compliance also. Viral load is high, more than 50. So you have to consider IV zuruvudine also. Okay. So these are the, if the SORM is there, we have to deliver within 24 hours. And this is the recommendations. So her viral load is more than 50. So she falls in the category of immediate section. And as she viral load is more than 50, okay, it is more than 50. So, and also there had been concern about her compliance. So IV zuruvudine will also be added. So answer becomes section and zuruvudine.
Ma'am, for SROM, no GBS prophylaxis.
How much is the third? She is at 37, 34 to 37 weeks. We are giving GBS, less than that. Okay.
Okay. Up to 37.
After 37, why you will give GBS?
Okay. No need. Okay, ma'am.
Options, ma'am.
should be intravenous zidovudine with immediate augmentation.
But she's keen for normal vaginal delivery.
But you can't help it. What is your guideline says? So she is a rupture of membrane, 37 weeks, okay, and her viral load is 2,000. It's 2,000 viral load. You have to give, go for cesarean section.
Zidovudine and
cesarean.
And viral
load.
Other people, please mute yourself. And as her viral load is more than 50, okay, so she's a candidate for IV zidovudine also. So answer is zidovudine and immediate cesarean section. Someone wrote R and E. So, you know, antibiotic prophylaxis for GBS steroid and MDT to discuss mode of delivery. So she is 37 weeks. So at 37 weeks, why you want to give her steroid? Madhu wrote this. Why you want to give her steroid? Why you want to give it GBS? Why you want to intervene MDT for this discuss? No, E is not a right answer. Someone wrote R also. So what is R? IV zidovudine and section.
R is...
R should be the answer.
R should be the answer.
Yes, R should be the answer. What I wrote. Okay. It is not, answer is R only, but they have put O. So answer is intravenous zidovudine and immediate CS. So R is the answer according to this table. But it is intravenous zidovudine and immediate section. Okay, so this would be the answer. Immediate section and IV zidovudine. Same kind of question. Rupture of membrane, viral load high. What you will do?
Again, zidovudine and cesarean.
Yes, again, same. So now see, this also happens in the exam. Same one EMQ and same answer. They want to confuse. Therefore, you have to always, you know, see question very well, because when the same answer is there, so we think, okay, we are doing wrong. But no, you go simple with the simple mathematics. Rupture of membrane, I have to deliver this viral load is very high, she goes for cesarean. Viral load is more than 50, she goes for IV zidovudine. Just think like that, write your answer, then search for the option. So this could be possibility in the exam. Whole three parts of EMQ, answer will be same.
I HIV resistance testing, ma'am.
Yeah, that could be the answer, but so this patient, she is at 28 weeks. Okay, we just read if the patient comes late at 28 weeks, without resistance testing, we will start medication.
Start ART.
Okay. So what will be the answer?
G.
Yes. Commence CART immediately without delay. So now we just read this. If the patient is coming late at 28 weeks without resistance testing, we'll immediately start treatment. Okay, so like. So this is neonatal management.
It's very low risk.
Very good. So what do you do for very low risk?
Okay, zidobutane for 2 weeks.
Very good, excellent. So zidobutane for 2 weeks is the answer.
Okay, it should be L. It's low risk.
Yes, answer will be zidobutane for 4 weeks.
Why?
Yes. Why? Though her viral load is less, but she has to take it more than 10 weeks. So she has not taken more than 10 weeks.
It's very high risk. PPE.
PPE, okay, see the options. Very good, Madhu got it. So Madhu, what is the answer?
IV zidobutane.
Very good. Preterm baby, IV zidobutane. Okay, IV zidobutane for preterm. She is 32 weeks. You know, reading every single part of question is really important. So if you see it here, okay, more than 50 put in high risk. So you can put answer what? You will put this as an answer. CART for 4 weeks. HRT. Ideally, this is the answer. If it is a term baby, so A will be the answer. But baby is preterm. Therefore, IV zidobutane becomes answer. Okay. So read question very well.
It should be F, defer testing until HIV status is known.
Very good. Why defer test? Because she's an IV drug abuser. So you don't know. She can be HIV positive. So you have to defer the testing till the status is known.
It should be G, defer testing until viral load is less than 50.
Yes, very good. Here this patient, here you already know that patient is HIV positive. So you will wait until the viral load becomes less than 50. So this is the question from previous guideline. Answer will be from the previous guideline. But in new update, you have to change it according to new update, because in new update, all testing schedule has been changed.
Z for
D.
E is the mother, it's breastfeeding, no?
Yeah, she's breastfeeding.
So it should be E.
Monthly. Yes, it because you have to do monthly after for 2 months after cessation of breastfeeding. Okay. So answer is E. No answer.
It should be E, ma'am.
She is breastfeeding. No, okay, there are two questions actually. Breastfeeding question is this one. This is breastfeeding question. Okay, there are two questions. Actually, I think I have shown it wrong. So this is the, in this page, in she is breastfeeding. So breast answer will be E in this question. It for breastfeeding, it will be 24 hours prior to discharge, 2 weeks of life, monthly till the duration of breastfeeding, 4 weeks and 8 weeks after cessation of breastfeeding. Okay, so this is the different question. What will be for 18?
It's not breastfeeding, so should be I.
Yes, it is I.
But it now, according I. to dentist guideline, it should be 22 to 24 months.
Yes, because this is answer from previous guideline. Now this has changed. So from the previous, it is I. But when this question will come to you, then they will change this antibody thing, or they will give you a different question. Okay, this we have done. Okay, so that's all for it. Any question you can ask?
Ma'am, we have to read this updated guideline for January exam.
Yes,